Series on going and making disciples, we are memorizing the gospel, Great Commission, from Matthew 28. And let's read this together before we read from 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." Do you see how that letter, if you go back to that last screen, remember Matthew is the one that tells us Emmanuel in Matthew 1, God with us. The letter ends with that idea, "I am with you always, Emmanuel." And he's with us as we grow in him and as we make disciples. And this morning, Nick Cole is going to be preaching the word of God to us this morning. Nick teaches in our Sunday school classes, our Bible class to the young adults. And I'm encouraged to hear him talk to us from the book of 1 Corinthians. And kind of just to set a scene for the immaturity to acting like men, I'd like to read chapter 3. As our scripture reading, would you follow along in your copy of God's word as I read 1 Corinthians chapter 3? Would you hear God's word, please? "But I, brothers and sisters, could not address you as spiritual people, but as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for it. And even now, you're not yet ready. For you are still of the flesh. For while there is jealousy and strife among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving only in a human way? For when one says, 'I follow Paul,' and another, 'I follow Apollos,' are you not being merely human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants, through whom you believed. As the Lord assigned to each, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. He who plants and he who waters are one, and each will receive his wages according to his labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it. For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is holy and you are that temple. Let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you thinks that he is wise in this age, let him become a fool, that he may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is folly with God. For it is written, 'He catches the wise in their craftiness.' And again, 'The Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile.' So let no one boast in men, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas, or the world or life or death, or the present or the future, all are yours. And you are Christ's. And Christ is God's." And God bless the reading of his word. Would you pray with me? Father, we are so grateful that we do not belong to anyone but Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you bought us with your precious blood. Thank you that you came in the flesh to show us what it means to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. What it means to follow you, to walk in your ways. What it means to serve you with joy. Our prayer this morning is that we would run from our childish ways, that this morning, God, you would convict us of our foolishness and help us to see how stupid, how immoral, how wicked it is. Help us to behave, to act like men and women in the image of God. Father, we pray for your servant Nick as he preaches, that you would uphold him and empower him, that we would see Jesus in him, and that we would love Jesus more because of Nick. Thank you for his desire and his study to preach to us this morning. May your spirit work in him mightily. Father, we also continue to ask that you would work mightily in the life of Sam Ryan as he has in his first week at boot camp. Watch over him, protect him from the evil one, we pray this week. Give him an ability, as we've been talking, to make disciples amongst the men and the women in which he is with. And Father, we also pray this morning that you would continue to bring your strength, your healing. There's so many in our church, and we just briefly mention a couple. Helen, Lord, we pray as well for Alice. We pray for Yvonne. We pray for Jeff's dad, Father, that your will would be done in his life. And if it be your will that you would strengthen him and sustain him, we would love that. Oh, Lord, this morning now, may your word be planted deep in us that we would grow in Jesus. In the Spirit, we ask that you would do your work in us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Children through fourth grade, you're dismissed at this time for Children's Church as Nick comes to give us the word.
Thank you for doing that. That's the part I always butcher. And the kids always sit through church and people in the back are like, hey, the kids! I'm like, oh, yeah. So, if you're not open to 1 Corinthians, please do so. I have sort of a confession as I'm talking about maturity and growing up. This morning at 8 a.m., my daughter Kara, she's 3, goes into our hall closet and grabs this little thing of makeup that I didn't even know existed, and she had me sit there with her and watch her put on her makeup, and it was fine. And when I thought she was done, I took it and I was ready to close it. She said, no. We gotta put some on you. And I said, thinking in my mind, I'm going to preach on maturity. I can't have this, man. And so if my eyes are sparkling purple, it's what you get. Let's pray together. Father, you sent us your Son. He ascended into heaven, and before he did, he said, make disciples of all nations, baptize them, and teach them to obey all the things that I've commanded. And I think, why would you have us do that? Are you blind? Do you know what kind of people we are? Why would you have sinful men and women take on such a burdensome, heavy glorious task to call on others to obey the commandments of Jesus when we ourselves fall so short so often. And all week long, I'm sitting here reading through 1 Corinthians thinking, I'm going to preach this against myself, let alone call on a congregation. So here I am. Help all of us. Help all of us to have our eyes opened to see the beauty, the glory of Jesus in a way that we can't get our eyes off of him. Help us this morning. That is the only hope we have in this task. So bless us this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. This is part 2 of 3. And Sean asked me a couple weeks ago what I was going through with the college age group. And I said, oh, I'm going through 1 Corinthians and talking about maturity. And he said, oh, good. You're going to preach on that. And I said, okay. All right, sounds good. At least I had something that I'm familiar with, so that's good. So often, last week including, you know, we talk about discipleship like it's something that we need to go out and do, right? We need to go find people to disciple, or hopefully you can find somebody to disciple you. And then you read things like this from 2 Timothy 2. And we talked about it last week. Wayne preached from it, and it says, entrust to faithful men. Entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. And Jesus says, teach them to obey all that I have commanded you. And the reality is, it's so easy to think, oh, who should I go disciple? Who should I be discipling right now? And so often, I'm coming to this, I'm reading 1 Corinthians, and I'm thinking, the reality is, this really does start with you and I learning to grow as Christians. It requires you and I to become that faithful person, right? Entrust to faithful men. So the question is this morning for me and for you is, how do I become that faithful person? That's what I want to be. Because the reality is, Paul doesn't say, go and disciple everybody. He doesn't say that. He doesn't say, go and trust things to everybody. He doesn't say that. He says, go and trust to faithful men and women. And the word faithful just means somebody who's been given a task to go do something and they go and do it. That's what faithful means. So, been going through 1 Corinthians, the young adults, talking about maturity, and that is one of, I would argue, the main themes in the book of Corinthians. And so, I've got some verses. I'm going to read 4 of them in particular. Where we're going to be going through Paul calling and recognizing the immaturity in the church in Corinth and calling them to grow up and be mature. And he's not talking, don't be fooled, he's not talking about your age. He's not talking about being 20, 25, 30, 50, 70 years old. That has nothing to do with it. Nothing. So I'll start chapter 13, if you go there with me. It's one of my main verses I want to hang out in, and we're going to visit it a couple times. Chapter 13, verse 11. He says this, when I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put away childish ways. Anybody who's been to a grocery store or has children knows exactly what he's talking about, right? You see children, you see the way they act, you watch them, you raise them, and you say, what are you doing? Why are you putting makeup on me? It is 8 a.m., right? What is going on? And Paul's saying, none of us are exempt from that. None of you skipped that, you realize. None of you weren't children. And every one of you, if God has given you the days to grow, has grown up. But that doesn't mean that you've put away childish behaviors. It doesn't mean that. You could be 70 and act like a 5-year-old. It's possible. And Paul's saying, if that's the case, it's time to put it away. Another verse. You don't have to flip there. I'm going to fire off three more. He says in 1 Corinthians 14:20, brothers, do not be children in your thinking. Be infants in evil, but in your thinking, be mature. Right? So here he is. Once again, guys, in Corinth, this is how I think Paul is talking to the church. Okay, guys, listen. You're infants in all the wrong things. You're thinking childish. Need to grow. You're thinking, you need to be thinking in a mature way. 1 Corinthians 3:1. But I, brothers, could not address you as spiritual people, but as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. And I imagine Paul is addressing 50-year-olds, 70-year-olds, 10-year-olds. I'm guessing. I don't know for sure. Infants. I can't even address you as people, and we're going to get back to this in a little bit. I can't even address you as people who are led by God's Spirit because you're infants in Jesus. There is no growth. None. 1 Corinthians 16:13. This is my last one. He says, be watchful, stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong. That phrase, act like men. Let me just say this. I've been doing college ministry for almost 10 years now. And I would say, if I could sum it all up, I would say this. There are almost zero expectations for young people to act like adults. Almost zero. And then you come to verses like this and Paul's saying, grow up. Be mature. Stop being infants in Christ. Act like men. Be strong. You hear that today. I'm not going to lie. With my background, I come out of a very, very liberal, very feminist background. It's just where I came out of. And if you say things like, act like a man, you get crucified. You do. And here's Paul saying it. I don't care. Grow up. Act like a man. Grow up, be strong. I am calling you to do these things. And he's not talking about being a macho man. I came out of that too. I played hockey and I thought I was, why is everybody laughing? Okay. I know I'm 5'6", all right. I know it, is that what you're laughing about? What's going on here? I came out of that. I came out of acting so tough as not what Paul has in mind. Talking about growing up in Jesus. So, as I have worked through this in my own life, and I see my own shortcomings, I see my own immaturities, especially the last 2 weeks, this is a real confession. I almost called up Sean 3 times this last week and said, dude, you got the wrong guy. Because, I mean, these things in here, a lot of them, yikes. I got a lot of growing to do. 3 times I almost did that. And I said, well, Paul says act like a man, so that's what I'm going to do. So here's what I'm going to do. I had 20 things that Paul addresses the church in Corinth on. I am not going through 20. I got it down to 10, and every time I went through this, it took well over an hour to get through, and I said, okay, I got it down to 8. So here we go. I have eight immaturities that Paul addresses with the church in Corinth. And I want you, as we go through them, to think, I'm hearing you, Paul. I'm hearing you address Corinth. Is that me? Are you talking about me? Is that me? That sounds like me. That's gonna happen. I hope it happens. And I hope every one of us is humble enough to say, that is me. I do act like a child. Jesus, help me. That's where I wanna go. So I have 8 things. I'm gonna read through them, and I want you to question along with me, is that me? Okay, number one, I just kind of group 2 things together. They're petty sin, they're petty immaturities, and I want to call them small, but they're not small, they're a big deal. The first one is this, he reiterates it in chapter 3, so we've kind of mentioned it already. It's where you have these Christians in chapter 1 arguing and quarreling about who discipled who. I am of Apollos. I don't care. I'm of Cephas. I'm of Paul. I'm of Jesus. Here's what he says. Verse 11, for it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there is quarreling among you, my brothers. You're fighting. You're fighting about this. You're arguing. You're dividing over it. Verse 12, what I mean is that each one of you says, I follow Paul, or I follow Apollos, or I follow Cephas, or I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? And Paul goes on, I thank God I only baptized two of you. I think. I don't remember. Then, but here we are. I can just hear Paul saying, guys, how did you come to Jesus as a Christian? Let's go back. Let's go back. This is what I hear Paul thinking, I think, to the church. Let's go back. You didn't know Jesus. You hear about him for the first time. By the power of God's Spirit, you are convicted of your sin. You despise it, that so much so that you confess publicly your own shame, humiliation, sin, and your disgust for it, and you want to repent and turn and have your mind changed. You're laid low. You're humbled. And you're filled with sorrow over this sin. And at the same time, you are filled with this joy. It's gone. It's gone. The sin that I've struggled with my whole life, I now have the power to overcome. And Jesus has forgiven me, and it's gone. That's how this started. And now you're arguing over who discipled you? You're quarreling about that? You're fighting your own brother about that. Grow up. Come back to how this all started, where you learned to treasure Jesus, despise the world, despise your sin. That's how it started. How did we digress to this? Another one I grouped together is with the church in Corinth, and I kind of want to, debating about how much context I want to put on this, because I know I only have so much time. Corinth is a hub, I'll say that word, is a hub for philosophy, okay, and new ideas, and brand new cool hipster thinking, okay? There's a lot going on intellectually, there's a lot going on a philosophical level, and this has absolutely infiltrated the church in Corinth in a bad way. And if anybody here knows the absolute stupidity of how this happens, I do, because I studied it for 4 years at Bowling Green. And if I could describe to you what I think studying 4 years of philosophy is, it's kind of like you're in a room. You're blindfolded, you're handcuffed, and you're all sitting together, and you're arguing about what's outside. What do the trees look like? You're blindfolded. You don't even know yourself, and you're trying to describe it to me? That's kind of what philosophy was for me. I am not even a Christian at this point, and I realize this is so dumb. This is silly. Are we seriously talking about this? Are you telling me? Prove that there's a water bottle in my hand. Okay, so you get it too. Okay, you get it. I'm not joking. We had week-long discussions about whether there is a material world. And I'm like, all right, I gotta go. I don't know if I can drop this class or what. I don't know what I gotta do. I acted like a man, and I stayed in, and then I met Jesus, and it was a little bit like my blindfold had been taken off, my hands were uncuffed, the power of sin gone, and then I'm watching this all happen, and my heart is breaking, and I'm saying, guys, you have no idea what you're talking about. You have no clue. You think that becoming wise means anything. It doesn't. This is exactly what's going on in Corinth. Okay, so I'm going to read to you a couple of verses. Verses 20, chapter 1, verses 20 to 25. He says, where is the one who is wise? Bring him forward. Who among you is all wise? Stand up. Go ahead. Let's talk. Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not yet know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. And again, I'm pausing, I'm thinking, I've seen this. I see it in my own life. I watched it for 4 years at Bowling Green. It is so stupid. And Paul is saying the exact same thing. Why do you think you've gained something? Adopting the worldly wisdom, you think you are wiser than anybody? Do I need to read any of this to show you that God uses the weak and the foolish things in the world to shame the wise? Do we need to go back to Moses? Do we need to go back to Elijah? Do we need to go back to Jeremiah? Do we need to do that? None of you are wise. The wisest among you is the one who grabs a hold of Jesus. He is the wisdom and the power of God. So I hear Paul saying, again, guys, how did we go from how we came to Jesus back to this? This is a life that Christ has called you out of. And I'm not saying don't engage in philosophy. I still read some. I'm shocked when I read it, but I do. But this is something I see Paul saying. Guys, you have got to grow up. Stop bickering with each other. Stop fighting. Stop being arrogant with each other, thinking you are wise. You aren't. The wisdom of God is Jesus. Grab a hold of him. You will be the wisest person on this planet. And it's a little bit like what Jesus said. I think it was the Sermon on the Mount when he said, listen, the one who builds his life on my words is like the one who built his house on the rock. And when the storms come, and they do come, the storms do come. When the storm comes, it's secure. It doesn't fall. That is wisdom. That is wisdom. You've left the world to be joined to Jesus, and now it's like you're going back, and I'm calling you to grow. Okay, that's number one. Number two, Paul sees that the church in Corinth is being led by their flesh. 1 Corinthians 3, I'm going to read verses 1 and 2 and 3. He says, but I, brothers, could not address you as spiritual people. You know, I hear that and I think, that's a problem. This is a church. And Paul's saying, I couldn't, when I write this to you, when I think of you, I can't even address you as being spiritual people, which I think, stealing from Romans 6, 7, 8, Galatians 5, Ephesians 2, stealing from all of those chapters, and I'm thinking, what I think Paul's saying is, I can't even address you as people who are following and obeying God's Spirit. All right? Here's why. Here's another reason I think that. But as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ, verse 2, I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you are not ready for it, and even now you are not yet ready. For you are still of the flesh. And this is what I think, stealing from all those different texts, what I think Paul's saying is, all right, I'm going to go back. Before you were a Christian, Ephesians 2, you were children of wrath by nature. That's what he says. You were children of wrath. You were dead in your sins when Jesus gave you new life. Not partially alive. You had a little bit going on there. You were dead in your sins. That's all you had going for you. Dead. Dead. I didn't know how to make that more clear. Dead in your sins. Jesus comes by the power of the Holy Spirit. You hear the gospel. This is how God works. Spirit of God, which all you were is flesh and dead. By flesh, I think Paul's referring to the sinful nature that you inherited from Adam. The tendency, the longing, the enjoyment, the pleasure in sin and sin only. Dead. Jesus comes, power of the Holy Spirit, you hear the gospel, you're converted, God makes you alive together with Jesus. That's how it works. And now you have the Spirit of God, okay? So you've got flesh in you and you've got Spirit in you, and this is what's going on. I don't care if you're 10 years old as a Christian or 50 years old as a Christian. This, flesh, Spirit, hate each other. Hate. And I think what Paul's saying is, what I want to see, I know this is going on. It's going on in me too. I'm thinking the end of Romans 7. I know what it's like to really want to honor Jesus, and there's still something in me that kills me because I want to do good and I don't. Kills me. I know what's going on internally with you, Corinth. I know about it. You're not deceiving me. What I think should be going on is as this is happening, the power of the Spirit is infinitely more powerful than the power of your flesh. And what should be going on is over time, you never get rid of the flesh. It never goes away, ever. So be encouraged. If you're a Christian right now and you're in this room and you're thinking, Nick, why am I still struggling? Why are these thoughts happening yesterday, this morning? Be encouraged. The power of the Spirit is infinitely stronger. And he's saying, it's like the Spirit's not even going on inside of you. The flesh has its desires, and you're people of the flesh. All you are doing is carrying out its every whim and desire. And I want to see growth. I'm not talking about perfection. I'm not talking about never sinning. I'm talking about growth. I'm feeding you with milk because that's all you can handle. You're infants in Christ. There needs to be growth. And there's no excuse. There's no like, well, I mean, hang on. Let's talk about my past. Hang on a second. I think Paul would say, the Spirit of God is so much more powerful at putting to death anything you've ever gone through, any desire in your heart, in your mind. And there's nothing. You're obeying its every whim. And I can't address you as being spiritual people. I'm addressing you as people of the flesh. And I want you to grow. I want you to grow. I want you to mature. That's kind of what I think, part of what Paul's getting at. 1 Corinthians 13:11, the verse we started out with. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put away those things, right? That's part of being a Christian. It is. Number three, what I hear Paul saying loud and clear is, I want you to take your sin much more seriously than you do. And this is a tough one. It's a tough one. This one was tough on me this week, I'll be honest. I want you to take your sin far more seriously than you do. Okay? Here's where I'm at. Chapter 5, verse 1, verse 2. He says, it is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and of a kind that is not tolerated even among pagans, for a man has his father's wife. In other words, he's saying, there's a guy among you that is committing sins that even pagans wouldn't tolerate. A guy is sleeping with his stepmom, and you're tolerating it. Verse 2, and you are arrogant. Ought you not rather to mourn? Let him who has done this be removed from among you. I'll be honest with you. I read this, and I struggled. Number one, I realized, I don't think I've ever heard anybody ever in my lifetime, okay, say something like, there is a man in our midst who is absolutely unrepenting of sin. Let's warn him. Let's go to him. And if he doesn't repent, kicked out. Never have I heard that. It's just kind of almost new in a sense to me. But I hear him saying, why are you laughing that this is going on? Why wouldn't you rather mourn? Why aren't there tears? Why aren't there tears that this is happening? Do you know what kind of example this guy is to the young kids in our church? Nobody cares? What's going on? Remove them. Chapter 5, verses 11 to 13. Another tough text. But now I am writing to you not to associate with anyone who bears the name of brother if he is guilty of sexual immorality or greed or is an idolater, a reviler, a drunkard, or swindler. Not even to eat with such a one. Whoa, 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 whoa. That's not the way I learned Jesus. Jesus tolerates everything. You're telling me don't eat with somebody who calls himself a Christian and is this? Not saying, I don't think Paul's saying, if there's somebody struggling among you, kick him out. That's not what he's talking about. Not what he's talking about. He's saying, if there is someone among you trying to pull the wool over everyone's eyes, bears the name of brother and is this, don't even eat with him. Is that the Jesus you know? This is a struggle. This is a tough one. Chapter 6, 9 through 10. He says, or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Don't be deceived. Do not be deceived. Don't let anyone question what I'm about to say and throw you off. Don't be deceived. Don't hear what I'm saying. I think I'm overemphasizing Paul here. I will admit that. But what I hear Paul saying, and it's important because our day and age, we can read a verse like this and say, yeah, yeah, but, you know, whatever. Paul's saying, don't be deceived. Don't hear what I'm saying and then say, yeah, no big deal. No big deal. This is what he says. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Yikes. I think I hear Paul saying, sober up. I debated about sharing this for time's sake and for content's sake, but I will share it. Before I was a Christian, I used to get really drunk. Okay? And if I can describe to you what it was like, and I'm sure some here could do it better. It was almost like you were absolutely deceived about reality, honestly. I mean, like all of a sudden, and this is why I drank, because I was absolutely depressed, thought about ending my life, and I wanted to escape, and I was so sick of everyone's solutions that made it 20 times worse, okay? This is what it was like for me. I want to forget about everything going on, everything. So I drank, and it helped for that hour or whatever. And I remember one time, I kind of developed this sense that I'm invincible. Nothing can harm me anymore. We had a guy on the first floor of my dorm, called him Jersey because he had a Jersey accent. That was a terrible Jersey accent impersonation, but we called him Jersey. And one time I had drank a lot and he punched me. And you know what happened? Instantly, all that drunken stupor was gone. And it was like, whoa, I am shocked back into reality. I am sobered up. What's up? Like, what just happened? That's how it was for me. Remember that so vividly. Trying to forget my problems, bam, get punched. I'm awake. Sobered up. I think that's exactly what Paul's doing to the church in Corinth. You guys are drunk. Not literally, not in alcohol. Wake up. It is an immaturity for us to come to Jesus repenting of the very sins, at least claiming to, I should say repenting. Because I don't believe in any of these descriptions. He's describing a Christian who's just struggling and relying on God to conquer sin. I don't believe that. And I'll tell you why in the next thing we deal with. I think Paul is talking about the one who is claiming Jesus and has no part with him at all. Don't be deceived. Lip service means nothing. It doesn't. It means nothing. You can talk all day. It doesn't get you anywhere. So sober up on the sins going around you and dealing with them the right way. Sober up about your own sins that are going on. We're not going to ignore them. We're not going to pretend like they're not there. We are going to seek God for his help. That's what we're going to do. And likewise, and this is another immaturity, it's actually the very next verse, number 4, 1 Corinthians 6:11. He says, and such were some of you, right? He just goes through this list of things. Don't be deceived. These people do not inherit the kingdom of God. The next verse, which I think Paul gives, is because it is so easy for you and I to not be sober, forget the seriousness of sin in us and around us, and then also go around talking about how grateful we are of salvation. And at the end of the day, we mean nothing in that. And I hear Paul saying, listen, such were some of you, but you were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. That is what God has called you out of. And you've been justified if you belong to him. You have. Nobody, Paul included, myself included, is saying, if you're struggling with sin, you need to feel guilty. If you're struggling with sin, you're not inheriting the kingdom of God. That's not what Paul is saying. He's saying, that's what you were. You have the power of God's Spirit in you to move forward. So I want you to sober up, and I want you to come with me. I want you to move forward. Put away these petty immaturities, and let's move forward, okay? Number 5, I think Paul is calling out. I had a number of things in between 4 and 5. In chapter 8, Paul deals with the concept of should we eat meat that's been sacrificed to a false god, right? There's people who came to Jesus in this church, more than likely, who know what it's like to serve and worship an idol. They came out of that, and they know what it's like to have an animal sacrificed for that god, false god, and then they would enjoy a celebration of eating that whatever it was afterwards, right? And there's some who say, I came out of that. That is absolutely godless. Filled with sin. I'm not going to have any part in that. And then on the other side, you have Christians, like most of us, I would think, who are like, what? I've never heard of that. That has nothing to do with me. That doesn't even correlate in my mind. I have no idea what that's like. So eating that meat to me wouldn't be a problem. I could eat it. I love steak. So why would I not, right? I want to eat that animal, right? Paul's saying, don't use that freedom that you have as a Christian to offend your brother in Christ, okay? That's kind of the context here. He goes in chapter 9 and he says, and then he gets more personal, he's like, hey guys, listen, I've actually used my freedom to become like people who are under the law because I want to win them. I want to win the Jews. I want the Jews to know Jesus. I have taken my rights and my liberties and I put them aside and I become like one who's under the law so I could be with those who are under the law so I can call them out. because I want them to know Jesus. There's nothing else. That's what I want. I've given that up. And he gets to chapter 10. He continues on his discourse of idolatry, and he ends it, last couple verses, with this. And this is what I think the church in Corinth has forgotten. There is one end to which we do all things. Whether you're eating, which references what I was just talking about, or whether you're drinking, I don't care what you're doing, or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. That is the one end by which Christians do all things. And I'm not seeing it in Corinth, guys. That's why Paul's writing this letter. You're doing this because you're proud and you're arrogant and you're quarreling with each other. You're bickering with your brother. I want to see you, Corinth, whether you're eating or drinking, whatever you're doing. I'm not talking about lip service. I'm talking about the motive that shapes everything within you. Do all to the glory of God. Do all things to honor Jesus, because where he has called you out of and where he has put you. It is an immaturity for us to be motivated by anything else. God's glory. Number six, Paul gets to chapter 12 and chapter 14, and he talks about the church's understanding of the spiritual gifts. And there's a ton we could talk about here, but what I really want to draw out for Corinth, For our sake, is that I hear Paul saying to them, you were not given gifts for yourself. You were given things. I don't think it's just spiritual gifts. You were given a car, you're given a job, you're given talents, you're given abilities, you're given whatever to use for the upbringing of the church. And some of you, and I've seen this before, I don't think I've seen it here, but I've seen it in other churches, where it's like, oh, you know what I think we should do? Let's take a spiritual gifts test. Let's take our tests. It'll tell you all what gift you've got. And then we all sit around, we take our tests, and we say, oh, look at that, I serve. I'm a servant. It's like, great, what are you doing? Just working and watching TV, that's what I do. All right, you've been given a gift and you're using it for what? You've been given things from the Lord to use to encourage, to uplift, to strengthen, to embolden, to disciple the church. And when one part of the body suffers, the entire thing does. You're selfish, Corinth. You only think about you. Thank goodness we don't have a Savior like that who literally could have stopped everyone nailing him to the cross. He could have said one thing and everybody would have been totally shut. You realize that? And he went. Did he have to? No. But he did it for you. He did it for me. So why? God has given you gifts. You have kept them to yourself. What is that? It's immature. That's what it is. Put away childish behavior. Chapter 13, this is number 7 that I have, is how I think Paul addresses the church on this topic. Corinth, you have a real love problem. You do. Because as you go around talking about your gifts, I have the gifts of the tongues of angels. I can speak in the tongues of men. I don't have any love, but it doesn't matter. I've used my gifts. And Paul's saying, no, you don't have love to join those gifts. You, all you are is a noisy gong and a clanging cymbal. That's all you are. You haven't done anything You know why I think the church in Corinth, I mean, I could give you 10 reasons probably, but one of the big reasons I think that churches, not just Corinth, have real love problems is because it's really, really tough. I work in a restaurant, okay? And I have people that I work with, and we talk about this all the time. It's amazing, the restaurant world. I know I'm past time. I'm going to keep going. Is that okay? You cool with that? Okay. Got a couple more things to say. We'll be done soon. Don't worry. I had one of my coworkers say to me, man, if you want to see total depravity, come work in a restaurant. It's amazing. People watch 2 episodes of Chopped and think they're food critics. And you're like, dude, chill out, man. You don't know anything about what you're talking about. It's amazing. It's amazing. And it's a very high stress, high tension place to be. It's very fast paced. And you do see a lot of other people's sin. You see your own, you see theirs. It's very tough not to fight and bicker and quarrel and complain and whine when you're sweating, you're running, and people are saying, I want my fries! Give me my fries! And you're like, dude, you're 50. Chill out, man. Good night. That happens daily. Daily. It's really hard to love those people. It is. It's tough. Let me read to you a description. I know this is oftentimes read at weddings, even though it has absolutely nothing to do with weddings. But then again, it has everything to do with weddings. So here it is. It says, verse 4, chapter 13, love is patient and kind. Well, all right. There's a challenge right there. In 12 hours of my day that I spend at a restaurant, that's tough. Patience. Kindness. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. Yikes. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. That's my challenge. Endurance. It's tough. Corinth, you've got a love problem. A lot of the things you are doing are the exact opposite of this. And that's not what I want. It's interesting. The first verse I read, 1 Corinthians 13:11, talking about putting away childish behavior and becoming a man, it comes straight out of the context of love, which I think is significant. I think there's a connection there. Paul's saying, listen, you want to be even a hint of mature, then pair it with what I just said, which is love. You learn to love somebody like that, who's going to call you immature? That's why at my restaurant, we struggle. It's tough. Lastly, Corinth, so I think Paul would say to them, Corinth, I believe you have forgotten that our focus as believers is on our victory in Jesus over death. And our resurrection in heaven is what we long for. So I'm going to read 15:50-57. He says, I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. You've forgotten. That's our focus. Jesus destroyed death. The thing that you were. You were dead in your sins, and Christ demolished it so you could have life. And now, our focus is on the resurrection in heaven, beholding the beauty of Jesus once and for all for eternity. Amen. That sounds awesome. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put up childish ways. Be watchful, stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong. These verses show up in the context of 8 things that I just read. I could have gone through 20. I could have gone through 25. And Paul is calling on us not to be perfect. He's not putting that burden on your shoulders. He's saying, guys, it's time to grow as Christians. It's time to stop obeying every whim and desire of your flesh and pray that God would strangle those desires. Because he will. It's time to grow up. It's time to act like men and women. Put away childish behaviors. And I think the connection between all of this and discipleship really does draw me back to 2 Timothy 2:2, talking about entrusting these things to faithful men. I'm trying to think of myself having a dialogue with Paul, and I'm thinking, Paul, what do you think about Corinth? Right? I just went through some of it. What do you think? And I think, I don't know. I think he would call on them to continue to grow, continue to disciple. But I think if we just said, oh, you just say, you know, just keep doing what you're doing, man. Keep discipling. I don't think that would be complete. I think he would say, no, you guys need to grow as Christians. So I ask 2 questions to you all. What childish things does Valley View need to put away? I know. I've been here for 3 years, and I've watched so many good things happen. I have. There's a lot of maturity here. I have no doubts. I've seen it. I listened to it. There is so much good going on here. And a lot of that really is the result of God's faithfulness and what he started when this church was planted years ago. Right? It is. And I know as we've discussed this about discipleship and growing up, what I've been praying for all week is that we will have myself, you, put away childish things as we disciple, because we want to see men and women in maturity, raising up more men and women in maturity. So question 2 is, what childish things do you need to put away in your life? And that question, I've been answering for 2 weeks, and I have a list for myself. And I think about this, and I think, let's not go through these things alone. Let's do them together as a church. Let's do them humbly, not with quarreling, not with arrogance. Let's do it together. Let's hear God's word. What is more important than hearing God speak and us listening? So I leave you with those 2 questions. I encourage you to continue on hearing God's word call on you to grow, mature, to get involved in a study of some sort at our church. Our church offers these things. Get involved, get somewhere. It's not so we can say, oh, thank the Lord, we went from 2 members to 9. Woo! That is so stupid. Please stop talking like that if you are. I'm going to do it. I'm going to commit to it. Let's pray. Father in heaven, there is an unbelievable amount of work you want to accomplish in this church. My guess is over the next 50 years, 100 years, 70 years, whatever. So many things you want to do. And we aren't anything but vessels. That's all we are, soldiers in line. Nothing special, nothing crazy, nothing new. This is the same Bible that we've had for 2,000 years over that. And you have the same calling for all of us. You draw us to yourself. We become conformed to the image of your Son. It's a miraculous work. And why you would continue addressing a church like Corinth with such immaturity, blows my mind. And you're so gentle with them. You're honest, but you're so gentle. You're so kind. You're calling them away from the fire of hell and into paradise. Why you're patient with a stiff-necked, arrogant, quarreling people like me, I have no idea. But please don't lose your patience with us. Work with us as we learn to grow, as we clink, as iron sharpens iron with each other. We do it internally, we do it externally. Lord, have us continue to grow. Have us continue to make disciples, passing on from one generation to the next, teaching all to obey all that Jesus has commanded, knowing the result is eternal life and joy. In Jesus' name, amen.